incredibly enlightening talks by our seniors. And I'd like to say that Serafina has saved some of the best for last. To say that she was an independent researcher would be an understatement. My biggest challenge was to keep my stress under control as deadlines would approach and I wouldn't hear from her. And another deadline would approach and I wouldn't hear from her. But I can honestly say that over the last 2 weeks, I have been incredibly impressed by the way her research has come together into a presentation that I think will not only enlighten you and educate you, but leave you with a feeling that we just don't know how far science will take us. So without any further ado, I would like to introduce to you Serafina Nieves and epigenetics.
First of all, I'd like to just say sorry to all the parents who thought they were done with school, all the students who thought this was Saturday, because you're about to learn a lot of stuff. Okay. We've often been told that things run in the family. Intellect, a certain behavior, cancer, and mental disorders. We've also been told that our DNA, more specifically our genes, are responsible for this. And for the most part, this is true. Biology teachers have taught conventional genetics in middle schools and high schools across the country for decades. In biology class, we learn the central dogma: one gene, one protein. We learn that the genetic code is the basis of life. It's what makes us us, and what makes us human. We learn that mental and physical changes that we undergo throughout our lifetime cannot be passed on to our children. For a long time now, our understanding of the world has been shaped by what we can clearly decipher from our genetic code. With the advent of epigenetics, however, we are coming to understand that conventional genetics cannot fully explain how DNA shapes us. More importantly, we are accumulating data that suggests that our environment shapes who we are, and who our children are, through our DNA. Throughout this presentation, I'd like to answer the following questions. What is epigenetics, and how does it work? How does epigenetics affect us? Why is there skepticism around certain modes of epigenetic inheritance? And why does our epigenome matter? Before we can explore the realm of epigenetics, we must have a basic understanding of what the phrase conventional genetics means. To do this, we will look at DNA, protein synthesis, and meiosis. First, we will look at the structure of DNA. This is a molecule of DNA. It is made up of a backbone, shown here, and four nucleotide base pairs. These bases are the building blocks of the genetic code. We have adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. A will only bind with T, and C will only bind with G. Nucleotide bases in different arrangements are what make up bits of code called codons. Many of these codons strung together make genes, which code for protein. But how do we get from one nucleotide to a protein? Our cells run on proteins, and this is what our genes code for. However, DNA itself does not create these proteins. Instead, DNA uncoils and allows free nucleotides, such as these, to attach to one strand, making a single-stranded RNA molecule that fits perfectly to the DNA. This is RNA. As you'll see, there's a difference. All of these bases are the same, except for uracil and thymine. For the purposes of this presentation, they're pretty much interchangeable. They won't affect your understanding. Uracil just takes the place of thymine in RNA. So where there was once a C on the DNA, there will be a G on the RNA. Where there was once a G, C, and where there was an A, there will be a U. As you can see, three of these bases make a codon. The codon corresponds to an amino acid, and this is a table of all of the amino acids and all of the possible combinations of nucleotide bases that will make those amino acids. The RNA is then packaged and sent out of the nucleus to the ribosome. The ribosome reads a series of three nucleotides at a time called a codon, and then creates a strand of the corresponding amino acids. So here we have the DNA. It has been transcribed to the RNA molecule that we just looked at, sent out of the nucleus to the ribosome. This is the ribosome. This structure right here is called the tRNA. This is what is called an anticodon. So you have the RNA right here, and anticodon will bind perfectly to each codon on the RNA, each segment. It brings an amino acid. A complete strand of amino acids is what gives us protein. Proteins comprise parts of the cell. They can assemble or disassemble certain molecules, break down compounds in our food, and provide our cells with the tools to make energy. All of our cells have the same genetic information, the same strand of DNA. However, our DNA isn't producing all of the corresponding proteins that it can all the time. Our cells in our bodies take cues from the environment and produce the necessary proteins. That is, certain types of cells only produce the proteins they need and only when they need them. If this weren't the case, as my biology teacher Ms. Grant says, the cells in your eyeballs would synthesize hair, and that would be really uncomfortable. So how is all of this genetic information passed on? Well, this has to do with mitosis and meiosis. So in mitosis, your somatic cells, or the non-reproductive cells, will divide and produce cells with the exact same genetic information as the parent cell. As you can see in the two resulting cells, you have the same number of chromosomes as the parent cell. In meiosis, or the creation of reproductive cells, your cells will divide and create cells with half of the genetic information of the parent cell. Notice that each of the four cells has only two chromosomes, while the parent cell has four. So a normal cell will have two copies of every gene, and a sex cell, only one. But these sex cells, or the eggs and the sperm, combine to form a fertilized egg with two copies of each gene, one from the mother and one from the father. This is how we end up genetically different from each parent, and how genetic information is passed down through generations. At least, this is how some information is passed down. Now that you hopefully have a basic understanding of how DNA functions and how proteins are made, we will explore what conventional genetics doesn't explain. First, let's define epigenetics. Let's look at the word itself. Genetics meaning the study of genes and how they function, and epi meaning on or around. So essentially, epigenetics means we're looking on or around our genetic code. The definition of epigenetics is the study of changes in gene function that are mitotically and or meiotically heritable and that do not entail a change in DNA sequence. As you can see, we are talking about modifying our DNA without changing our genetic code in ways that can be inherited by both non-reproductive cells and sex cells. What does this mean? It means there must be a mechanism that is not defined by conventional genetics that allows the passage of information to subsequent generations. So, we will look at two types of epigenetic mechanisms: histone acetylation and DNA methylation. These mechanisms are types of epigenetic regulation, meaning they control whether or not a gene produces protein. This is a chromosome, and it is made out of chromatin. Chromatin is essentially all of your genetic material and the structures that hold it together. A mass of RNA, DNA, and proteins, such as these histone proteins right here. Your DNA is neatly wound around these proteins, called histones. When chemical compounds, called acetyl groups, attach to these histones, they become acetylated, and the chromatin opens, as you can see by these spaced out histone proteins right here. The histone proteins decondense the chromatin, making it easier for the DNA to be read, transcribed into RNA, and make protein. When the histone is deacetylated, however, the chromatin becomes more condensed, as you can see right here with two histone proteins that are closer together, and the DNA is less likely to be transcribed into RNA and make proteins. When the DNA is not being transcribed and translated into proteins, the gene is inactive. When the opposite is true, the gene is active. In a sense, our genes are turning off and on based on whether or not the histone is acetylated. The next type of epigenetic regulation we will be talking about is DNA methylation. This mechanism involves the attachment of methyl groups to the nucleotide cytosine, but only if it is adjacent to a guanine. When DNA is methylated in a certain location, that portion of DNA is less likely to be recognized because it has unfamiliar chemical attachments. It is therefore less likely to be read, transcribed into RNA, and translated into protein. So to recap, histone acetylation makes histones farther apart, opening the chromatin, making it more likely that DNA is transcribed into RNA, translated into protein, essentially meaning the gene is active. When it's deacetylated, the gene will be inactive, and when the DNA is methylated, it is harder for the cell to recognize this portion of DNA, transcribe it into RNA, turn it into protein. This part of the gene will be inactive. So what places these chemical attachments on our DNA? This is what conventional genetics can't explain. Many of you were probably taught in biology that the environment cannot affect you in ways that can be inherited by your children. But the environment is what places these modifications in our genetic material that results in changes in our phenotype. Your genotype is what your genes say. Your phenotype are the observations we can make in the real world. Essentially, your genome is more than just your genetic code. So how does the epigenome affect us? I hope you guys now feel like experts on protein synthesis and genome. Now we will investigate what all this epigenetic gibberish is actually doing to our bodies. We will look at case studies that examine various environmental stimuli and the effects it has had on people. The first case study details the epigenetic effects of the Dutch Hunger Winter. The Dutch Hunger Winter was a famine that took place from 1944 to 1945 in the Netherlands, when the Germans had obstructed the entry of food and fuel. This resulted in the year-long famine that changed the lives of those who experienced it and the lives of their children. If the mother experienced the famine while her baby was in the second and third trimester of gestation, that baby was born smaller due to malnutrition. This baby also had a lower risk for obesity compared to the general population. That seems logical, no? The mother experienced the famine while her baby was in the first trimester, however. That baby was born average size. While the baby was malnourished in the first trimester, it had time to catch up in the second and third trimesters. However, These babies also saw higher incidences of both obesity and heart disease. In addition, women who were prenatally exposed to the famine in the first trimester also saw higher risk of developing breast cancer. Generally, those prenatally exposed to the famine in any capacity were significantly more prone to developing schizophrenia. These effects mostly pertain to what we think of as physical ailments. But what about mental ones? Here we will examine case studies performed with Holocaust survivors. This is the liberation of Auschwitz. Millions of people, Jews, gays, and the disabled, among others, were subject to terrifying and cruel conditions. The survivors endured forced labor that brought them to the brink of death, starvation, beatings, and the execution of loved ones. This trauma affected their genomes in ways no one could predict. For many of those who survived the Holocaust, the suffering did not end. Many came away with post-traumatic stress disorder. All of the children of those survivors are more prone to depression. Interestingly, only those whose mothers suffered from PTSD are at higher risk for second-generation PTSD. This study shows the negative effects that can result from trauma and affect someone for a lifetime, even going on to affect their offspring through epigenetic inheritance. The FKBP5 gene inhibits the function of glucocorticoid receptors, which regulate stress hormones. Survivors of the Holocaust had 10% more methylation of this gene when compared to those who did not experience the Holocaust. This means that the FKBP5 gene cannot inhibit the regulation of stress hormones. The methylation of this gene has been closely linked with stress-related disorders. While many children of the Holocaust survivors do experience stress-related disorders, some studies have shown that the children of survivors have 7.7 lower methylation of the FKBP5 gene when compared to the children of those who did not experience the Holocaust. So what could this mean? These inverse methylation trends are not completely understood, making the potential effects of the pattern unclear. However, this situation also points to an exciting prospect. While the traumatic experiences of the parent generation may beget vulnerability in our youth, these same experiences may also inspire resilience in our DNA. 9/11 provides a piece of the epigenetic puzzle that can't be found in either the Dutch famine or the Holocaust case studies. Pregnant mothers who witnessed the events on 9/11 gave birth to children that had elevated levels of the stress hormone cortisol. Unlike the other case studies we've examined, these children were tested when they were very young, mostly around 1 year old. This suggests that any elevated levels of stress hormones would be due to the experience of the mother and not to recounting of traumatic stories to young children. Researchers were concerned that survivors of the Holocaust and the Dutch famine were unknowingly traumatizing their children through storytelling. Drugs can also affect your epigenome. Drugs can epigenetically modify your DNA, promoting an addictive phenotype that can last for a lifetime. This is why drug abusers have trouble quitting drugs, and also why people can have relapses even years after they've stopped abusing. They say you are what you eat. It's a great figurative expression. But maybe you are what your parents ate. In this diagram, we are looking at the agouti gene, a gene that all mammals have. One group of mice were fed a diet with folic acid and B vitamins, methyl-containing compounds, while another group of mice were fed a diet deficient in these methyl-containing compounds. The result is that the DNA of the first group, shown here, is methylated normally, producing healthy brown offspring, while the DNA of the second group, shown here, is hypomethylated. It does not have any methyl groups on the DNA, which produced obese yellow offspring, more prone to cancer and diabetes. Our diet can also affect how we process toxins. Another experiment was performed with mice that were fed a standard diet and mice that were fed a diet supplemented with folic acid and B vitamins. In addition to these diets, all of the mice were also fed bisphenol A, or BPA, a chemical compound you're probably familiar with, found in some plastic food and drink packaging. The mice that were fed the diet supplemented with folic acid and B vitamins resembled the offspring of the mouse on the right, while the mice that were fed the standard diet had offspring that resembled the mouse on the left. This experiment was performed hundreds of times with different mice over multiple generations, demonstrating that diet does indeed have effects that can spread throughout a family tree. Here is a relatively well-known photograph of the lynching of two black men, Thomas Shipp and Abram Smith, in the 1930s. For this presentation, though, I'd like to focus on this section right here. Now, if you went to Ivy Senior X, you learned towards the end of her presentation that the concept of whiteness and its oppression of what is associated with the concept of blackness is incredibly damaging to not only black people, but white people too. How? The condition of post-traumatic slave syndrome describes the effect that the traumatic experiences of slaves had on future generations. These effects would be similar to those that we've examined in the Holocaust case study. As we could note from the earlier photo, the suffering and trauma of black people in America extended far beyond the end of slavery. This trauma, too, would make future generations more vulnerable to anxiety, depression, and second generation PTSD. If there were such profound effects on the victim of this trauma, it seems unlikely that those who were directly involved in or complicit with these events came away epigenetically unscathed. Ibby said that while whiteness is detrimental to black people, it hollows white people. My question is, by forcing epigenetic trauma upon others, do we force epigenetic suppression of our own empathy? So all of these case studies and experiments seem pretty convincing, right? Why should we doubt the power of epigenetic inheritance? Here is a pregnant woman smoking a cigarette. The effects of the cigarette not only extend to her body, but the body of her fetus, as you might expect. Additionally, the chemicals in the cigarette will also make changes to the reproductive cells of the female fetus. As a female fetus is born with all of the eggs it will carry throughout its lifetime. In this way, it would require four generations to determine that any changes in the phenotype of an individual were due to epigenetic inheritance and not to direct exposure to the environmental stimulus. There is a study that has worked to overcome these obstacles in epigenetic research. This study was conducted with many trials, many different mice, and the chemical acetophenone. Acetophenone is a sweet-smelling chemical resembling the smell of almonds. Mice are attracted to this smell, but when the mice in this study were placed in the presence of acetophenone, they were given a mild foot shock. After multiple repetitions, the mice began to associate the chemical with pain and displayed agitated and anxious behaviors. Even when the foot shock was no longer applied, the mice still became anxious in the presence of acetophenone. The offspring of these mice, as well as the following generation, also exhibited anxiety and agitation. Interestingly, the mice that responded with anxiety also had heightened sensitivity to this chemical, possessing more receptors to pick up the smell. Even when the eggs and sperm of these mice were fertilized in vitro, they produced similar results. When the offspring of mice that displayed anxious behavior were cared for by mice who had not been exposed to hook shock, the mice still grew up to be anxious when in the presence of acetophenone. This study shows that mice's behavior was due to epigenetic inheritance and not direct exposure nor the behaviors of the parents. So why does your epigenome matter? So many things can affect our epigenome, having consequences that can last multiple generations. But why should we pay attention to these factors? And why is it important to understand how epigenetic mechanisms change our DNA? We've all gotten along pretty well without understanding epigenetics, right? We are making great strides in the field of genetics and epigenetics. We are on the brink of these fields, just barely able to ascertain the kind of power that DNA has over our bodies and our world. Likewise, we are coming to realize the power we have over our DNA, the power we have to manipulate our environment, the power our environment has to manipulate us, our children, the unconceived future generations. And the more we uncover, the more obligation we feel to consider our decisions and our situations, the more responsibility we have to our genetic code. We are discovering how our decisions and our situations, starting from the day we are born, affect us for the rest of our lives, affect our children, affect the rest of the world for many generations, for many lifetimes over. Our DNA has the power to cage us in or to set us free. This is why our epigenome matters. This is the kind of power we never imagined we had, and the kind of responsibility we never knew we cared.